March 4th, 1996, the survivor is Bent Lerno, interviewer Temi Margolis, language is English, and the country is the USA. Simi Valley, USA. My name is Temi Margolis, T-E-M-M-I-E. M-A-R-G-O-L-I-S. I'm conducting this testimony with Bent Lerno, B-E-N-T-L-E-R-N-O, in Simi Valley, California, in the USA. And that's it. Today's date is March 4th, 1996. Please tell me your name and spell it.
My name is Bent Lerno, B-E-N-T-L-E-R-N-O.
And what was your name at birth?
My name at birth was Sally Levitin, L-E-V-I-T-I-N.
And your Hebrew name, Bent?
I got the name of Shlomo, S-L-O-M-O.
And what is your birth date?
January 22nd, 1927.
And your age?
I am 69 years old.
And where were you born?
I was born in a place called Charlottenlund, Copenhagen, Denmark.
All right. I would like you to tell me about your early years and your suburb that you lived in, and background of your mother and dad and brothers and sisters.
I was, like I said, lived in a suburb called Charlottenlund. We lived in a, I guess, a fairly nice home, but my father wanted to build the basement under it. In those days also there was no basement, and the house started falling down into the basement. So the engineers came out and said that unfortunately they couldn't do anything and the house should be torn down. So my father instead built the first high-rise outside Copenhagen, which was a five-story apartment house. And it was finished in 1928, and it is still standing there today. I had three brothers and a sister. My oldest brother, I had two that have passed away before I was born, so I thought that it's no sense of naming them. But my oldest brother, Richard, was born in 1911. This year he will be 85 years old. My second brother, which I passed on, was Harry. And I have a sister, Ida, I-D-A, Ida. Her married name was Goldine. And she was married to a doctor, which later became my doctor until he passed away. And then my brother Paul, which is about 2 years older than I am. Paul and I have been, I will say, real good friends all those years, and have enjoyed each other's company. And like I was just in Denmark visiting him, but we will come to that later. We lived in Charlottenlund till about 1930. Then my father bought a villa, which we call in Denmark a villa, in a town called Hellerup. It was a little closer to Copenhagen, but it was like a private home. Before that, we lived in our own apartment house up on the fifth floor, but there was too much for my mother to run up and down five flight of stairs. And in those days, elevators wasn't modern, so that is one of the reasons. And so we moved to Hellerup in 1930. And I was put into a kindergarten, which I walked to every day myself, and were there till I started school. And I started school in 1933. And that was Hellerup School, which just 2 years ago had 100 years anniversary, so it is still standing and are still used as a school. Today is used as an international school. And that's, I went to school, and I graduated at an early age, because in Denmark you don't have to, if you don't have, what shall I say, the ambition to go the academic way, then I chose not to, and I chose then, in Denmark, it's known that you become an apprentice. And I was lucky to get apprenticeship in a big mechanical company. But it was a little more taught the old-fashioned way of whatever you made your own things like blacksmithing and things like this. And it was a hard journey, you know, on bicycle. It took an hour on bicycle to every day. You had to be there 7 o'clock in the morning, that meaning at the I had to leave the house before 6, and you had to be up at 5, you know, and so it was hard time. And in Denmark, it gets awfully cold in the winter time. And I think in 1942 and 1943 was the hardest winters that we ever had, until actually this year, where it beats all records, you know. It got so cold that you could actually walk on the ice between Denmark and Sweden, and that's about 8 miles across. So, of course, so that people shouldn't escape from Denmark, the Germans sent their icebreakers out all the time, you know, and, to clear the stray. And, excuse me, and that was actually where we were, going to school, enjoying. We had a summer home outside Copenhagen, which was in a place called Hornbæk. It was such a beautiful ride up to the summer house. It was called the French Riviera in Denmark, you know, that you drive up along the coastline, and it's all water, and it's really beautiful to see. And so we had a fairly good time, and when it was a big Jewish holidays, we always went to synagogue, and we had family friends like the Ginsburg, the Abramovich, and whatever else, Epel, were some friends, and those were people I knew because my parents played bridge with the elder group, but on big holidays we always got together. And of course, around holiday time, my mother had three sisters. The one we didn't see so often, she lived far away, but the other two lived right around us in Hellerup and Charlottenlund. So on one holiday we were at our house, and on the next holiday or the second holiday, we were at my one aunt's house, and so on and so forth. So the family were always together. And that first started breaking up when everybody of my older brothers and my sister got married, then, and my aunt and uncle's children also got married, and it kind of fizzled out, like one say, because then you get your own family unit. And that was what it was, but we went to the synagogue in Copenhagen, and so on the big holidays, because it was quite a ride to get in there. And of course, it wasn't so much that you just came to the synagogue, that was the part that you always looked at, you know, and so that you had to take the train that was in. You could always buy the ticket the day before, and therefore you didn't use money, but that was what you had to do. And I remember the big holidays, how they were standing from early morning to late night, you know, in the synagogue, and then we went home, and then my father asked us to come back, and we cried, and we said, no, it takes so long, and it was very hard, you know. But that time we had a rabbi, his name was Friediger, was of German extraction, you know, and asked to come to Denmark to become rabbi. But he had a funny thing that he really didn't try to learn Danish, and so he was very hard to understand, and that did, I had my bar mitzvah with him, or confirmation, whatever you said in those days, and he was almost impossible, and I thought many times it would be nicer to go out skiing instead of going in there on Sunday and onto religious teaching, you know, and so we never had this pressure, and you could say, with knowing that you were Jewish. I knew only from at in school, I didn't attend the religious hour that they had, so that day I could go and play or do whatever I wanted, and I thought that was neat, you know, and so nobody ever really bothered us, you know, and so you never thought about the difference. And I can tell you, in relation to this, that when I came to the United States, there were so many that asked me, what are you? I said, well, I'm Danish. And they said, well, Danish, what is a religion in Denmark? Oh, I said, the main religion is Lutheran. Oh. Then they turned around, then they, can I ask, are you Lutheran? I said, no, I'm Jewish. Oh, that was what we asked in the first place. I said, why? Because I had never been asked in Denmark. So I thought it was funny that I should be asked here. But of course, here things were changing. But so everything was going real great in Denmark. Like I say, I attended my work, and when I had my vacation, I went up to our summer place, and I enjoyed all the company of friends and relatives and whatever you have. And so I can only say at that point we lived a pretty good life until that was September, exactly the 30th of September 1943.
And what happened there?
We had, of course, a new rabbi, Marcus Melchior, which was the assistant rabbi. He was born in Denmark and raised, and but he was still the assistant rabbi. But people were wondering when he came in on September 30th, 1943, and wasn't in his robe and his round kippah, which they used in those days. And he came in and he said, everybody please sit down and be quiet. I have something to announce to you. He said, I have gotten it on good authority. He said, I can't name the man's name right now, but the Prime Minister of Denmark, or former Prime Minister of Denmark, Hans Hedtoft, have called me and said, at some weeks prior, the Germans had broken into the Jewish office, religious office in Copenhagen, of the rabbi and the whole congregation. You know, and they took the list of the names of all the Jews in Denmark. And we didn't know why, you know, they wanted copies of everybody, you know, and we never thought about it. But now we have it on good authority on Yom Kippur, which is October 1st, the Germans are coming and want to take all the Jews and put them in concentration camp. So he said, I beg of you to go home right now, all of you there is here, and start calling your friend, your relatives, all you can, and have them again call others, and etc., etc., so that it spread out. And I got that afternoon a telephone call and I was 16 years old. And I said to my mother, something is really wrong. Tomorrow when it's Yom Kippur, and we were going to go to the Ginsburgs, there's not going to be anything because we all have to get out because the Germans are going to take the Jews. And of course, first my mother didn't believe it. So she said, I said, I am leaving, and my brother Paul is leaving, and we had a friend over, and he said, I'm going with you. So we just packed a little bit in a little box and paper bags or whatever we could find, you know, to just enough, put enough clothes on so we could be warm because it was really cold already in October. My mother said she would stay with friends and wait for my father to come back from the city. And, of course, we had Germans living right across the street from us. It was German officers. It was like there was, they had this villa that was across there where they lived, and they could enjoy life when they were away from Germany itself. And then we used the backyard. We had cut a hole in the fence, and it was family of the famous painter Gauguin that lived in the back of us. So we slipped out there. We went to the railroad station. We had a little bit of money with us, and then we took the train up to our summer town. But we were again afraid of staying in our summer home because we presumed that the Germans knew that was where we would be. So we stayed with some very good friends. It was a set of twins, Philip and Gio, or Philip and George Mattson. And so we stayed with them, and they said, nah, it's probably just a false alarm and whatever you have, and don't worry about it. We will stay here for a couple of days first, and we will see what happened.
Excuse me, did you ever hear what was going on in Germany and Eastern Europe at this time?
We knew that something was going on, but of course, Germany had a very good propaganda machine, and therefore all what was known to be bad and so on was made in light, and this is just hearsay. And but we did see pictures, some pictures that had been smuggled out. And so, but you can't really describe what it, how can I say it, how and it really was there until maybe as you saw it, you know. And so it wasn't really in our minds to know. We knew that something was going on. We knew that things wasn't in Denmark as they had been before because, of course, the Germans took everything there was to take. They took butter, sugar, and they had first right to everything, to meat and so on. So for the Danes, everything got rationed. You know, they took all cars from dealerships and shipped them to Germany, and they took all our food and everything else. So we were going around with ration card, couldn't get tobacco, couldn't get anything. So it was pretty bad. But anyway, we were up in the summer town, and we called our friend's house in Copenhagen. My mother said, I'm coming up today with your aunt and uncle and his brother, and we will go to their little cabin, and then we will contact you. We know where you are. I said, yeah, we are right across on Church Street, you know, from the church itself. The family is called Mattson. And, my mother said, yeah, I know the boys well. So I said, fine. My father hadn't finished business yet, and he was trying to get friends to come into our house to stay there so the Germans wouldn't see it open. So they came there every day, even though they didn't live there, you know, and took care of the house. And so now we are sitting up and waiting for my mother, and then finally she came up to the summer town. Then it was my uncle's and uncle's brother, Uncle Leopold and his brother Elias, and my aunt Olga. They had a friend. He was next door to their little cabin, you know, and he said he would help them. So my mother said, why don't we have him arrange things and so on? And we said, okay, what else could we say? So we were going to go now outside of the city, toward south of the city of Hornbeck. This is just a summer town of about 3,000 people. So we went to the forest, and we know the German were lying in the forest, and they were protecting the sea coast, they say, of Denmark. So they had built big concrete internment there, and had big cannons sitting there and everything else, but you couldn't see it from the road because it was behind the forest. So anyway, we went to this fisherman's house. It was about 4 kilometers, which is about 3 miles south of Hornbeck. It's a little red house on the side. And it had like a little outhouse, which they stored furniture, wooden furniture, and so on and so forth. And we had to be there at 8 o'clock. And so my brother Paul, my friend Ralph, and myself, we took bicycles. My mother and her family took the bus.
And can you tell me the last names?
My aunt and uncle, his name was Leopold Abramson. He originally came down to Denmark from Norway, so he has S-O-N in the end of his name instead of S-E-N. And my uncle's brother Elias is also Abramson, and my aunt Olga, of course, born Solomon, like my mom. And those are the ones, they had no children, so they came as they were. So now we go to this house, and we are sitting in the outhouse, and we are waiting, and we are waiting, and we are waiting, and no fishing boat, no nothing is happening. And you are sitting there, and it's cold, and it's rainy. And finally, around 11 o'clock, somebody comes and very quietly knock on the door and say, you better go home because we was just told that there is no fishing boat coming tonight. So that we had figured on leaving the bicycles there, and they were going to be picked up the next day. So we said, well, us three, we will take the bicycles. And my mother, again with her family, took the buses going in the other direction, and that's coming. The last bus is coming from the city of Elsinore going up toward Hornbeck, and that would be there about something like 10 past 11. So we waited till we saw it. They were aboard, and the bus took off. And so us three on bicycles, we follow the bus into the forest. Now, when we come into the forest ourselves and we come closer up toward the city of Hornbeck, we see the bright lights of the brakes of this bus. And at once we saw it stopped, we knew something was wrong because the bus never stopped there. And what it was, that we had been sold out by my uncle's friend next door. We didn't know that he was a Nazi sympathizer, even though they had been friends with him for 25 years. And for $5, I think, something like $5 a piece, we were sold out. And how we found out afterwards was that my friends went to the bus driver when we saw at the bus had come into the city of Hornbeck and nobody was there. And he said that the Germans had boarded the bus and they stood with the list with 7 names on and read it off. And they took my mother and, they took the 4 people that were in the bus. But they knew specifically who they were. So when they asked for the names, and they said, yes, it's me, and yes, it's me. And of course they said, please step out. And they had to step out of the bus, and that we had seen it stop. We figured something was, like I said, something was wrong. So we said, let's get the hell out of here. And I think that with the speed of bicycles through part of the forest and up a back road and around the whole back way, it was like another 6 miles around till you can go a back road and then come into the city on the backside and then to the friend's house. I would say at that time I would have set the speed record of bicycling in a dark forest because we were that scared, we had no lights, and the rain was coming down slowly, but still it was cold. And so we finally come into the city of Hornbeck and we said, what is happening? You know, and so our friend said, we will sneak from here, walk, because we had curfews, you know, and after 10 o'clock you couldn't go out. You know, but they snuck out anyway. And like I say, they went to the chauffeur of the bus and he said he don't know what happened, but he said they had their names, they had everything. And first we didn't know who to blame, but we said, the only ones we have talked to is you guys. And the only one is the restaurateur that owns a big restaurant, the farmhouse in Hornbeck. And then also, I think that was the only one that my mother had talked to. And so, of course, later on, there was others that he gave up. And there was a special some from the underground that he sold out to the Germans, which was taken. And then they knew that it could only be them because they had been at the restaurant that night before. And the next day they were taken by the Germans and they knew that he owned the restaurant. So that would be the only one it could be. So by the underground court, he was condemned and later was executed.
What was his name?
I can't remember his name. That I have to find out sooner or later, you know. And I never thought about getting his name, who owned it. But you see, people have passed on, and many of my friends, you know, have gone. And so there's very few, and even that you can ask anymore where it says, and who was at, and so on and so forth. But I never thought about it, but next time I go to Denmark, I definitely will try and get his name, you know, because it was also not an important person in the whole scenario, but he was one that really made it miserable. So we tried a couple of other times to get across. And it was canceled before. They said the water was too choppy and there was too many patrol boats out and so on. But on the 6th, actually we started on the 5th of October. We were told there was a place called Dronningmølle. It's like the Queen's Mill. There was a little city also of maybe some hundred people, and they had a big cement factory and roof tile, those red roof tile factory that was lying off the road and then down onto the beach because that's where they stored all the big pipes and cement blocks and everything else what you have. We were told to meet there at 8 o'clock, and so our friends took us there. And
who is us?
That was myself, my brother Paul, my friend Ralph Ginsberg, then my father, and then there was other people. There was a famous Danish musician called Max Galka. When we were ready, after my mother had been taken by the Germans, we were trying to find out, of course, where they had taken her. But the only thing that the chauffeur could say was that they were going to be taken to Copenhagen. So we had our friends that was trying, the Madsens, to see if they could find out to some of their family in Copenhagen what was happening. And they said that many was going to be taken to Germany. And that was all we knew. Then my father had called from Copenhagen and said, I'm ready. How am I going to get there? So we told my father to take the train from Copenhagen to Elsinore. Of course, disguise himself a little bit, you know, to not look like everybody else, you know. And just look like the average Joe citizen, you know, that's doing some business, have a little valise and so on and so forth. So my father took the train and nobody bothered asking him any questions or anything. He had bought a ticket and he went on the train and came to the city of Elsinore. Like I say, that is 12 miles or 12 kilometers, which is about 8 miles from our city of Hornbeck. So we figured, how are we going to get him up here? So somebody suggested that I go on bicycle because I was the least suspicious character. So I went to my friend. There was his father was a blacksmith in the summer town of Hornbeck. And I borrowed my friend's clothes, blacksmith clothes, which is all greasy, oily, dirty clothes, you know, and I had a blacksmith hat on, you know. And so I took the one bicycle and rode with another one next to me. And I bicycled the 8 miles first into the city of Elsinore, and there my father was coming out of the station. And I told my father, I said, can you ride the bicycle? Because I had never seen my father on a bicycle. But my father was very agile, and he had a store repairing bicycles, and he had a motorcycle factory and all this in the old days before I were born. So he just said, sure, I can ride the bicycle, and he went on the bicycle. And now that I didn't have to have the second bicycle, we went all the way across the back roads, which made it even longer than 8 miles. I'll say maybe we drove 10 or 12 miles on bicycles. And at that time, my father was already 62 years old, but he did very well, you know, and we drove all the way up to the back to the city of Hornbeck and into the Madsens. And that was on the 4th of October, he came up. So he stayed with us. And then we were told that the next day, it looked very good on the 5th. And so, like I say, we went to this beach area where we were taken down by some already that was helping. And we sat in those big clay pipes down on the beach. Now, other Jews had come there, which I only remember the names of one because he was a great musician called Max Skalka. And he came with a whole suitcase full of all his life's work, you know, and music he has written and all. And my father said to him, you can't take that. That weighs just as much as a person, you know. So the people that helped us down said, we will store it, so don't worry, one day you will get it back. And, of course, he didn't know if he ever would get it back or whatever. But now, in time, we were sitting down on the beach. It was cold, it was raining, and there was a little bit of wind, but not that much. So at 10 o'clock, we heard this fishing schooner come, like you hear, tuk, 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 and then it stopped. And then there was a rowboat down on the beach, and the fishing, one of the helpers on the fishing boat came in. And he looked around and he said, hey, you're way too many. We can only take half of you. So they took mostly women and children and family that belonged together. And he said, I'll be back. And then he sailed out. And at 2 o'clock in the morning, we heard in the distance the chucking of this fishing boat. And we knew that now it was soon time. And I could hear my own teeth, going pretty bad, because that was how cold it was. And so here we were, and now we knew it was time, and we were, I think there was 9 of us left. And among them were my father, Herman Lerno, my brother, Paul, my friend, Ralph, and myself, and a few other people. And all of a sudden, we just scooted very quick down to where the boat were, and we jumped in and waded out to where the fishing boat were, and we got on. And when I saw this boat, I figured, how in the world is he making it across the Strait of Øresund? Because it was a rather small fishing boat. It was not one of the big ones which we normally saw down in the harbor. It was like little size. And so I didn't want to go down into the fishing boat, so I stood up on the side of it and held on to the side, and then he turned the fishing schooner around and started going across the strait. And then we heard away across, we saw lights coming from both sides. And we were out in the middle of the open ocean. And he was steering up or north first, and then the boat going a little faster across because the current was so strong that he kept going up north, and then it scooted down south. Then he went up north, and then we went back south again. And it was choppy seas now. And if I swore to myself, I said, I will never sail again, because I have never gotten that sick and not, I can say it honestly, not thrown up, because I have not done that since I was 5 years old, I think. And there I was, my brother was sick, my father, it always looked like it. He was a giant, to me, even he was no taller than I were, but he was, because nothing ever faced him as such from that time when he escaped out of Russia. I guess he had been to it, So here we were. Now, finally, we see the first one that's coming against us is the Swedish patrol boat. A Swedish destroyer that's going in behind us into the open sea. And he's just very slowly going that way. And so we had time to get into Swedish territorial water. And we could see when we were in Swedish territorial water that the Swedish destroyer had turned around and was now going south. And at the same time, a big German patrol boat was coming from the north, going down south, and of course they were too late for anything. So, and they never confronted really the Swedish Navy. So we chuckled for another hour, until we finally hit a Swedish town called Höganäs. And there we came into the harbor, and the Swedish police was there, and we were led up to a high school where in the gym was laid out mattresses and all, and then they told us the next morning we had to give name and address and so on, but we were so wet and so cold, and finally the next day we got some dry clothes. And then they helped us. They said, if you have family in Sweden, then you should call them and see if they can help you get into the town or someplace. Otherwise, you will be in like in a military camp until we can place you around in Sweden. So we had my sister Ida. She was married to Joel Goldin, which had a sister that lived in Gothenburg, Sweden. Her name was Esther Garelic, and we're married to Sam. And we called them and asked if they would give their name to the police, and if we could use their name, then we would get train tickets to come to Gothenburg. And so we told them that we would call again and let them know when the train was leaving, etc. And they picked us up and we walked then afterwards to their house. And when we got there, there was already, the apartment was full. It was like that we were Norwegian sardines in a can. That was how many people there were. We were eating in shifts because we couldn't all eat at the same time. There was not room for it. So right away, we all tried to see if we could find. And then my brother and my friend left us and went to his family, which has also come over to Sweden. So with just my brother Paul and I, we got one room in an apartment that was rented for us. And my father got another room in another place that was rented for him. So then we got some money. And then, of course, we started right away looking for work. And my brother got a job, and I got a job, and my father got a job. Even though not too many, my father was more or less like a helper, but it all helped, you know, to sustain ourselves, you know. And even though we got help from the Swedish government, I must say, they were very nice to us, you know, and helped us with a lot of things. And we could buy clothes at a very reasonable price that they set for us new immigrants into Sweden. And so this is in 1943. So things were going pretty good. Of course, we were told to make packages, and to the Swedish Red Cross, they would try and find out where my mother was, and they found out that she was in a place called Terezinstadt in Czechoslovakia. And if we made Red Cross packages, then they would get it. We made almost every 2 weeks that we make packages up, and we got cans and pot flowers, you know, and we put medication into the flour. We open up the packages so it couldn't be seen and glued them together again. But later when we asked my mother, she said sometimes she got a little bit, but she got some potato flour one time and some other things. But all the chocolate and candies and things we saw that would help them a little bit in surviving, you know, never arrived. We knew why, because the Germans took it, you know, confiscated it, whatever they did, you know. So I heard that there was a free Danish army being built up in Sweden. In those days, it was just called the police force. But this was among my friends. There was a couple of other school friends that had come. There was one, his name was Per Eliasson. And there was another one, his name was Louis Meyer. And we had met each other, and we went out at night, and we went to the amusement park, Liseberg, in Gothenburg, and had good times. But we also thought about our friends at home, that how hard a time that they went through. So I wrote to the Danish General Consulate in Stockholm, Sweden, and said that I would like to volunteer into this police force. I wrote back and said, how old are you? And, I said, 17 and a half. It said that you had to be 18, but I said I was 17 and a half, and thought physically I was strong enough to be able to volunteer. So they said, okay. And I needed my father's consent. My father thought that there was a great idea, so he said, okay. And in October of 1944, I had gotten a ticket to come to Stockholm, and from Stockholm I was with a train there to go to this camp that we were going to. And of course, when I got off the bus, you were in mud up to your ankles already, you know. And yeah, I said, oh, my nice clothes and all. And, then that night, we were just given a place to sleep, you know, a bunk, and that was it. And the next day, we were outside, and we got our numbers and papers and everything else. And then we got what they called uniforms, which was not that warm clothes, you know, and we had rain and sleet, and soon it began to snow, and so it was hard training every day, and it was training and training and training. I don't remember anything else, you know, and sleeping and walking or running and learning fighting and shooting and going to the shooting range, and the food was not there. It was like real army food, you know, but then of course the sweets I never ate as good as the Danes, so it was even worse, you felt, you know, and many of us got sick from bad food and everything else. But at least we built up units, and my two other brothers, or we were four brothers actually that wanted to volunteer. But my older brother already had too many kids, so they didn't want him to volunteer. So we were three brothers in the army at the same time, my brother Paul and my brother Harry. But they were in different battalions because they volunteered at the different times after me. I was the first one in, and they first came in early 45. And so in April of 45, we knew, we had heard on the radio at Prince Bernadotte and the Danish Red Cross and Danish chauffeurs and buses that was painted white had gone to Germany. The Swedish prince had negotiated with Himmler of at all Scandinavian prisoners should be returned to the country of origin. And at that time, Germany had already started falling, so they made a deal with Himmler, and the buses were sent out to Denmark. That was in April of 1945, to Germany, and into Czechoslovakia, and they came to the camp, and my mother didn't know it, maybe till an hour before. They wondered what those buses were coming into the city for. And they were told to pack all their things or take the least with them as possible, but border the buses, and that was it. My mother took, she had been working as a maid, as a cleanup woman, as a stacking books and all and other things from other prisoners that had come into the camp. They had come in, and it was like they was there maybe a couple of days, and then the Germans again sent them on cattle cars, and there was Eastern Europe's Jews, you know, that came in, Italian Jews, wherever they came from, into this camp of Theresienstadt, and from there they were sent on to Auschwitz, and maybe some to Belsen and other extermination camps. And so there was those two things that my mother had seen in this room as she had stacked things. There was a prayer book, which was a book that when it opened, It opened on the page, and inside was two things that was pressed in it. It was a four-leaf clover and an Edelweiss, which was the song Edelweiss. You know, and my mother took kind of, when she saw that, you know, she said, she put the kind of book aside. And then there was a front shawl of a Catholic priest, which she saw was a beautiful brocade. And she had put those aside, and she went, she said, I'll be back in a minute, and she went into her workplace. And even though the German was standing outside, she packed up the book and the shawl and a piece of paper, you know, and walked out. And the Germans never said anything to her, and she went up on a bus and she took this with her. Anyway, she came back. I will talk about those two things later. But she, they boarded the bus, and I, she never really told me how many days it took to drive to Germany, first Czechoslovakia and then Germany into Hamburg or around Hamburg and then up to southern Schleswig and then into Denmark, across Denmark, and then they were ferried across to Sweden because the war was still raging. And my mother said that ever so often they stopped. That was when there was bombings of Germany. And so the buses stopped, you know, and the buses otherwise never stopped. There was two chauffeurs on each bus. So, and when they were driving, they drove 4 hours at a time, and then one chauffeur slipped in back of the other, and the other one took to the right, and then the bus kept driving. And my mother said when they came to Kiel, which of course from the Kieler Canal was a German port, and my mother said that she could see part of a church tower. Otherwise, she said when she looked to the left when they were driving in a bus, you could see from one side of Kiel to the other side, right through it. It was all flat. And then finally they came up to southern Schleswig, which was at one time part of Denmark, but now is Germany. And she said there it was like nothing ever had happened there because it was just farms and all, and they were still there. And when they came into Denmark, they were given flowers and hugs and screams and welcome home, you know. My mother just said she just sat there and cried. And then the buses went across Sweden. I had gone to my commander and said, I know that a train is coming up to Stockholm on the 17th. He said, we are on ready alert. But he said, I'll tell you, I'll give you the trip into Stockholm, and you see the train, and then you come right back. And I said, thank you, you know, and I left. And I went to Stockholm. Unfortunately, there was two columns of trains. One went up to Stockholm, and the other column went to a city called Helsingborg. And my mother, unfortunately, was on the other train. So, but I saw an old girlfriend that had also been interned that came up, and it was her, Kate Huffcore was her name. Later, she married a friend of mine. And I asked her if she knew where my mother was. She said, I think she is on the other train. So then I had no more reason to stay there. I saw the rabbi Friediger. He had also been interned because he never believed that the Germans would come to the house. And so at the Seder, Yom Kippur night, they came and just knocked on the door, and he went and opened the door, and they just left. I mean, they took them, you know. So then I had no other reason to stay, that I knew that they were free now. And I went back to camp the same day. I went to the captain. I thanked him for letting me. So he said, I want you to be in charge of all ammunition, and there will be a column of trucks, you know, and you will write front gun on the truck, you know, and said whatever. And so we went to the southern part of Sweden and were lying there in camp. We were lying in tents, and we slept, I think, there was 24 in each tent, you know, and they had like a little stove in the middle which didn't do nothing, you know. So for 2 weeks we were lying there freezing our rear ends off. And unfortunately, the Germans in Germany capitulated to the British on the 4th of May at 8 o'clock at night. But nobody knew it in Denmark till the 5th of May. And on the 5th of May, we were moving to the harbor in Elsinore, and we sailed across to Denmark. We thought we were going to be greeted by Germans' guns coming across the Strait, and so we were all in full gear, lying on the bottom of the on the decks, you know, with our guns ready and all ready to go aboard to Denmark. And instead, we were shouted "Welcome home!" About the 10,000 people in the city of Elsinore. It was such a beautiful sight that you can't. We have the Hamlet Castle on the right and the beaches on the left, you know, and here sits a harbor, and here was red and white flags put up, you know, and people would just started shouting, "Welcome home." But of course, as a military unit, you can't always do, you know, we got flowers, and then we start marching from Elsinore into Copenhagen. And then we were gonna overnight at schools around the city, and the school that we came to was called Husum Street School. I just took a picture here when I was in Denmark my last time. On the 5th of May, it was funny to see the school again, the backyard where we were lying and had our open fights with the Germans. We lost 3 soldiers because the still Danish Quislings and the Danish Nazis were attacking us, you know, and of course we blew them out of the sky, but we lost 3. But we were sent the next day, we were already sent to down to the border of Denmark and Germany to take over the border guarding. And there we met the British unit which had been fighting before in start of the war in Tobruk. So it was an old unit, you know, of British soldiers. And then later came the Americans up too. And so we were called, when I say it, the Danish Brigade, but we got an American name because it was all under Eisenhower and Montgomery, so we were called Danforce. That was our military unit was called. And so we got the border patrol together with the British, and that meant that we now were thrown out all the Germans from Denmark. And this is, of course, 1945 now. And from the 5th of May to the end of July, when we were sent home, because on that span of time, the Danish military already were functioning, that we had all our units had come in, and all the, what shall I say, the directors of the units and all, with the former Danish military, was all called up again. And so new Danish units were called back into service, and in July they were all ready, and then we relinquished all our weapons, and that was it at that point.
Lee, then Lerno.
Okay, I'd like... Bent, I would like you to tell me what happened to your family when you returned to Denmark, who and how many returned with you, and then go on with your life.
Okay. Like I say, there was four of my family. There was, we call it concentration camp because that's what it was. But my mom, Martha Lerno, my aunt, Olga Abramson, and my uncle, Leopold Abramson, and his brother, Elias Abramson, all came back with the Danish Red Cross, the white buses, as they are now. There is a bus in what was a Danish concentration camp in Denmark. Has now part of it been made into a museum, and one of the buses are there. But I will come back to all that because that will come up later. Like I say, they took all the Danes that was there. Some snuck over and came with them. And you mentioned too, there was a number, I thought there was 420, but that could be 430, however, ever, because I asked my mom things, and it was very hard to get things out of her. I can tell you, she talked about when the Danish Red Cross, during the time of the war was going on, came to inspect this place, because they had made it like that this was how all camps were in Germany. This was actually an old city which they had emptied. And now they kept them all in those lousy places that was like the slums of everything. And that's where they were. But of course, it was better than if you had been in Auschwitz. And my mother saw so many come to the camp and then leave again. And many she could speak to because my mother spoke German fluently. And little Yiddish and some Hebrew, but this wasn't used much in Europe, you know. So my mother had seen atrocities, you know. They had been called out at 4 o'clock in the morning and stand because something was missing or something was happening. And she said there was a hanging going on and other things. But they never knew. And when the Red Cross came to inspect it, at that day, everything was polished up. Everything was clean. They had a Philharmonic orchestra that was playing. They had kids playing out in the park like they had cleaned up. They were like soccer games, you know, and there was candy standing out. The only thing where nobody could touch any of it. Till they were told to come over and serve. And then those... Red Cross that came down was nothing but Danish Nazis, so of course they wrote that they were well taken care of in these camps and how the Germans were, and that was used for propaganda. And at once, it was like that you go to Universal Studio, you know, and you drive in those nice buses around and you see all the fronts of all those nice buildings. The only thing it was just the facades of all what was going on. So there, that day, the Red Cross saw the front of Theresienstadt, and at once the buses left, everything was taken away, and nobody could touch anything, and it was back to being prisoners. And so now you saw the backside of Universal, and that was how it was. So life went on, and my mother had to work and cook and do kitchen duties and all, and a couple of times my mother stole some of the food, you know, and even though it was pork, my mother said to all the kids and to whoever was sick, eat it, and you cannot, the most important thing is to survive. So whatever we can get and eat and take, do it. I think my mother, again I say her name, Marta Lerno, was probably one of the key factors in that a lot of people knew her and knew that she was really with it. And even when she come back, I must say that my mother, of course, had suffered by it, but that was internally, and that you couldn't see to the outside. When time came, like I said, there was an hour before they were told that those buses are here for you guys, and that was it. But they didn't take anybody else, and just whatever was Norwegian or Swedish and so on and so forth. And my uncle's brother was a bachelor, had met a lady, I can only say her first name, I know it was Hanka. She was from Czechoslovakia somewhere, and somehow she got to Denmark with this group, and how she did it I don't know, and my uncle's brother married her afterwards, and she became Hanka Abramson. So, but that was how they were driven to Germany and into Denmark and then over to Sweden, and in Sweden they went to health checks up and medical treatments and all for malnutrition and so on and so forth. Of course, they weren't as bad as when I were lying at the border and saw there was French prisoners came up to Denmark. And if you saw bus fulls of just absolutely skeletons, bones and skin was all, and we were warned, do not give them anything, only if they want a cigarette. It was all we could give. They told us, do not give them food, because they have to go to a whole regiment of food over the next year. And I have seen dead people, I mean, afterwards while lying by the border in Germany, but this here was the worst of the worst, that you really see the piles of bones lying, the stiff bodies just lying around. This was just stiff bodies that were still alive. And I remember specifically giving a Frenchman a cigarette, and the only thing I got was just the eyes, a blink with the eyes. That was thank you, I presume. But so my mother had come to Sweden, and I didn't see my mother, of course, until that I was sent home for the military, which was toward the end of July of 1945. And we were sent home, and because we had to give our uniform, so we had some old clothes on, and they had stored our clothes, so finally I could change into regular street clothes. And then my mom and dad had been out walking, and I was standing outside our home in Hellorp, and I saw my mother and my father come walking. And of course, I must say that my mother and father have never really been, because they had never learned to be excited, you know, in such a way, you know, that you show emotion or you show love. But I knew it was there. I went and hugged my mother, and of course shook hands with my father, because that was what men did. You know, God forbid that you should kiss each other, you know. And I taught them that later, after I'd been in the United States. But this was the first time that I met my mother since October of 43. That was in July of 1945. Our home was there. Our friends had kept it exactly as it was when we left. It just had to be cleaned up a little. And so life was, in a sense, back to normalcy, but not what you could ever be back to normal again. Because I had lost friends, and I had lost part of my childhood, you know, and of course, I would say some of the maybe most important years, from 16 till you are 18, where you really are grown up, and I did it in military duty, you know, and, but I'm thankful for whatever was done for us. I would say, from your fellow Dane of different backgrounds, but we were all Danes. And I have maybe appreciated that more, I would say, after my now life. Life was going on. I became an apprentice again, and I got in, of course, to a different type of company. I got into a small company which was called IBUL, IEBUL, because my two bosses were young bosses. They had inherited the company from their father. And the one, his first name was Ib, I-B, and the other one was Ulf, U-L-F. So they used those two letters each of the first name, and that became the company name. We made optical instruments, surveying instruments, binoculars and all, and that's where I finished my apprenticeship. And as my apprenticeship, I finished in 1947. I made a surveying instrument from the bottom up. The committee came, you made the raw material halfway finished, and then they came and they stamped it with a deep stamp in them so that you couldn't cheat when you had to finish the instrument. I made my own lenses for the optical instrument. In those days, we ground our own lenses. The crosshair was used on lenses in those days were Black Widow spider cocoons that you unrolled them after you killed the spider, you know, and that was put across the lens as a crosshair. And I finished with a nice mention on my certificate of master mechanic now, or instrument maker, as it was called. Of course, that became a good thing because in the United States that became a very nice and noble trade. And so we had a funny incident. I mean, we went to our summer town and we enjoyed Hornbeck. And my two friends that lived there during the wartime, the Madsen, had now moved to another city in Denmark. And I will tell you how I met one of them later on, you know, and almost 50 years later. And in 1949, I had family in New York. My uncle and aunt, Max Itkin and Elsa Itkin, and their son Charlie, had gone to the World's Fair in 1939. And they came on the same ship as now Victor Borge, that time Borge Rosenbaum, came to the United States to the World's Fair. And, of course, the war broke out. Now they couldn't go back. So Borge Rosenbaum became Victor Borge because he got a recording contract with the Victor Recording Company. They said, your name is too long, you know, and that was when they said his first name was good as his last name because it's Borge in Danish. But because you don't have that line through the O, it become Borge. So they said Victor Borge. That was how his name came about. Of course, my last name now, Lerno, is also an O in the end with two dots over or a line through it. So, but when I came to the United States, because I put a line through the O, people erased it and thought that it shouldn't be there. So I learned just to put O, so that became Lerno. And he came, my cousin and her husband came to Denmark in 1945 to visit family then. At that time, he brought his big 1949 Cadillac with him to Copenhagen. And I was so impressed by this car and by, I should say, their coming to Denmark, that I thought it was just... So my cousin looked at me, and I was out driving in his car, and I thought it was like I had gone to heaven. And I said, I'm going to buy one like that, you know. And so my cousin and her husband said to me, Joe and Jerry, I called them Khalid, C-O-L-L-I-T-T. They had a food delicacy store in New York that was called Old Denmark. It was on East 57, 135 East 57th Street, right next to Lexington Avenue. And so he said, why don't you come? You're single, you're young. Why don't you come to the United States and see if you like it in the United States? So I said, okay, that sounds good. So I started filling out papers. Of course, in those days, it was 9 months, you know, it took to fill out all the papers. And he had to send over guaranteed papers that when you come to the United States, he would be responsible for me. And so I wasn't, that the government had to pay me and so on and so forth. But I came to the United States. And now the time had passed by. I came in 1951, on the 13th of January in 1951, I came to the United States. I was supposed to have come in December, but the weather was so bad, they canceled the shipping that time, so I had to wait till the 7th, 6th or 7th of January before we got out on SS Stockholm. We sailed with. Normally the transportation that time took 6 days to sail across from Sweden to New York. But it took 13 days because we hit into storm. So I had left that time right after New Year, and we arrived deader than you can even think, because even then I was lying almost 3 days in a bed just hanging on. And then finally the water smoothed out, and there was like glass, you know, and it was very nice. So I came to New York, and I was picked up by a cousin because we had been so late that not the whole family was there, just my cousin Charlie Itkin. We worked that time for a big pen, Everest, I think it was, the pen company was called. And so he came down to East 57th Street Pier and picked me up. And he said the best place to stay is at the Sloan House. I didn't know what that was. It was a YMCA on 34th Street in New York. And the worst place of many places, but it was cheap, so it was okay. The next day I took a bus up to my cousin's store, and he gave me a lunch. And I thought, gee, it would be nice to work here, you know, and he has a nice store here and everything else, and that would be great. But what happened was that after the lunch, which I always remember was $1.61 with tax, he sent me over to, we walked a quarter of a block over to Lexington, and he pointed down and said, that line down, four blocks down is... on Lexington Avenue is 54th Street, and you will see a sign outside that say employment offered. You go up there and just ask them for a job. I already called them and told them that you were coming. What am I going to do? You know, I went down there. This is on a Thursday, I think. And I went down there, and I went up to the employment agency, and in my Danish, German, English, which were pretty bad, I got myself a job as he thought I was an apprentice. I was trying to explain to him that I had finished my apprenticeship and so on. But he got me a job, and I was going to start the next Monday. So I went back. We had found a Swedish guy, his name, or Danish guy, Finn Nielsen. was his name. He was going to work for United Nations. We've got an apartment down, or apartment room down in the Greenwich Village on James Street. So we moved down there, and then I walked over to where I was going to work, because it was only 4 or 5 blocks over. Then I was there on 15th Street and 7th Avenue. And James Street was between 7th and 8th Avenue on 14th Street, so it wasn't that far to walk. I started there on Monday, and of course they thought I was an apprentice, you know, so they gave me funny things to do, like sweeping the floor and cleaning up equipment, and et cetera, et cetera. Until I finally started talking to the foreman. He was an old German that had been over 40 years in the United States in those days. So I spoke little German, and I brought in my certificate, and I said to him in German, I am not an apprentice. I am a full-fledged mechanic. And he looked at my certificate and said, sehr gut. Then he took me into the office and he said, hey, we made a mistake. You know, he is a tool and die maker. He is full-fledged mechanic, you know. So in those days, they had started me on $37 a week. You know, I went from $37 a week to $137. And that was quite a difference, you know. So now I could begin to save a little bit of money. So I worked for a year and a half in the United States. And I thought it was the greatest of all. So, but I knew at the paper they had given me were only for a year and a half first. Then I had to go back to Denmark, so I went back. And right away after a week, I went back into the American embassy, and I said to them, I have such a great future in the United States, and I want to go back. But they said, the visa we gave you is that you have to stay 9 months, but we will put in the papers for you so they will be ready in 9 months. And so in the meantime, I got a job in Denmark. And then at that time, my father wanted to go on a trip, and my mother didn't. She didn't want to leave Denmark. So I went with my father in 1951-52. I went with my father to Israel on a trip. I didn't realize that time that my father had already started getting sick. So when we finally arrived in Italy at the place after Venice, we went to Bari and Brindisi. And in Brindisi, we boarded a ship that was going to take us from Brindisi to Haifa. And the first day out, when we were sailed to the Corinth Canal and then into the Mediterranean Ocean, my father said, I want to go home. What is all this water? Why are we here? And I thought, what is wrong? You know, but of course didn't know. And so when we came to Israel, I had to call my brother in Denmark, because you couldn't buy a ticket in Israel. You had to buy it in Denmark and have it sent there. So he got a ticket to SAS. I just started flying there. And the next day, my father left Israel already. And I stayed there for a couple of weeks. I figured I'm here, you know. And then when I came back, my family thought that I had taken all my father's money and everything else. And I said, you guys are crazy, you know. This is, go and look in his overcoat. I stuck everything in his overcoat in the outside pocket. And my brother went down the hallway and opened the closet. There was his money, his papers, his passport, and everything else. That kind of upset me a little bit, because I had been away already now from the family for the second time. So I said, this is it. I'm leaving as soon as I can. Went to the embassy, begged and cried and said, I must leave, you know. And finally I got the paper, so now I could go back to the same place I had been, you know. And but this time I had the permit to stay, you know? So I came back to New York. I stayed in New York, got a job, and worked there for a while, and enjoyed the time. I'm a member of the Danish soccer club out in Bay Ridge, Long Island. And then I met some other Danes at the Sloan House in when we were down playing badminton. And they had just come back from Houston, Texas. And they said, oh, it's God's country, you know, and so I went to Houston, Texas, and we met this Dane that they had given the name and address, and he the next day sent us to a construction company that was owned by a Norwegian called Tellefsen's Construction Company, and he hired us, boom, right on the spot, you know, and we lied an inch or two, you know, but that was just, they asked, can you drive trucks and can you do this, and we said yes to everything. We figured we are not going to say no. The next day we had to meet way out of the city, and we didn't know we were going to build a bridge. And so the foreman was told by Mr. Tellefsen that we were going to work there, and this was what we were going to do. So the guy says, okay, see that truck down there? He said, I want you to go down and learn to drive that and then drive it all the way out there and see all those tree poles that is out there. He said, you go and pick them up and bring them up here. Luckily, there was two trucks that was doing that. So we saw how the other truck was hooking them on, you know, and we went down and with tape, we put on all the gear shifts. We were trying first what the gear shifts were doing because we didn't know. So we wrote a note on it and say, this one goes up, this one goes down, and all in Danish, you know, and stuck them on. So we could read, and when we had to have it go down, it came down, you know, and when it had to go up, we had to pull the other lever, and when we had to lift up the arm and then swing the big poles, you know. And then, of course, so the poles wasn't swinging, we had a third helper, a black helper. Why I say now black was because I had never known that there was any difference until we came to Houston, Texas. We had separate bathrooms and separate fountains you washed your hands in. And so that was first time that we ever saw what discrimination was. Or I could say there was a second time. First time when you found out that what it was to be a Jew, and now what it was to that somebody had a different color on you, which we never considered. But anyway, we had a job, and I worked there 2 weeks. My friend worked there longer. He was a Swede, Gunnar Schelin, was his name. He stayed with the company. I got a job in a big oil company instead, and that was indoors, and that was a much better job, you know. So I took that. And then in 1956... I left Texas. I had told them I was coming back, but I went back to my parents because they had golden wedding anniversary. Fortunately or unfortunately, I met a girl there, and I married her. Her name was Margit Blackman. And I had to get paperwork first for her so I could bring her back to America, but then her family talked me into go to California because my mother-in-law had a sister that lived in Los Angeles. So I figured, well, what am I going to do? In the meantime, in Copenhagen, when I came to my parents' wedding anniversary, I met an American. And I will tell you the name afterwards, but he said, if you ever come to California, here's my card, call me up, you know. And so for the time before I got married, I was out with this guy a lot of times in Copenhagen. I had a fantastic time. Now, I went back to United States, and then I packed up all my things I had in Houston, Texas, and drove my old car to California. And finally found the family near Olympic Boulevard on Wilshire Boulevard in Los Angeles. And her name, and we came to the aunt, was Lisa Leon. And they lived on Plymouth Avenue in Los Angeles. So I stayed there with them for a couple of weeks till I could find my own apartment. But I figured I would wait till at my wife Margit would come over. It took a while because of getting her paperwork and so on, and finally she came.
what happened next, Ben?
Well, my wife, Margit, came, and of course, my friend I had met in Copenhagen, his name was Johnny Stampanato. He got me a job here in Los Angeles, and so things were going pretty smooth until that I went out with Johnny and his girlfriend one night. There was Lana Turner. We had a good time. We were at the Crescendo nightclub, and the next day I wrote in the newspaper at Walter Winchell at the scene. It said Johnny Stampanato was seen with Lana Turner and an unknown couple. And the unknown couple was, of course, me. And then later on, Lana Turner's daughter, Tilt, my friend Johnny Stampanato. Well, things weren't that good because I got my in-laws over, and things took kind of a bad turn. And we had now two children. There was Debbie and Bent Herman Jr. And my in-laws interfered all the time in our marriage, and finally we got a separation, my wife Margit and I, and she moved into Palms in Los Angeles, which were against what the judge had ordered, and I came every Sunday and I had my children for a visit. All of a sudden, I came in to visit him one Sunday, and the apartment was empty. And I got kind of shocked. And I asked, I went to the landlord, then asked the landlord, where is the Blackmans? And he said, oh, didn't you know, at Thursday, they all left for Denmark? And I called the Danish embassy, and I called around and found out that she had falsely written the children's name in her passport, and she smuggled them out of the United States because it was against the judge's rule. And what could I do? Nothing. So I called my brother in Denmark, and he said, take it easy. Don't come running right after them because they are in hiding. So just to say that, I'll go on. But for 9 years, I didn't see my children. They hid them from my mother. My ex-wife went to my mother in Denmark and said, I want some money from you, otherwise you won't see the kids. So my mother said, you're not going to get any money. I haven't seen your kids up till now, so do whatever you think you have to do. And my mother, till she passed away, she never saw the kids. Anyway, I lived on here in Los Angeles. I had lived in Encino, and then I had bought a home in Simi Valley. But of course, I was back in 1960. So at that time, I worked in Van Nuys, so it was long to drive, so I sold the house again because they had stolen everything out of the house. The only thing I had was my bed and my clothes. The rest they had taken, all our wedding gifts, everything. I never saw anything of it ever again. That was my ex-wife, Margit, her mother and father, and some friends they had to help emptying the house when I were out Saturday night. Think about coming home from a party and then your whole house is like an empty stick. Anyway, life went on. I sold the house, and I moved into Canoga Park. That I had gotten a new job for Litton Industry, and part of Litton Industry were located in Canoga Park. And so, in 1963, my secretary at that time at Litton wanted me to come to a party. She belonged to a temple, Beth Cordes, in Canoga Park, and she was president of now the youth adult club for the Beth Cordes. And she said she was going to be installed as president, and she said if I wouldn't come to the installation. I said, no, I don't want to go and look at wallflowers, so forget it. You know? But she kept pushing me, and finally, she said, you get buy a ticket for $5. That includes some hors d'oeuvres and include two drinks. I figured, what for two drinks, what can I go wrong? So I bought a ticket. And I came there, and right away I said, oh, now I know why I'm sitting here at a bar and having a drink. But here come two ladies. They were both teachers with a third person, you know, which I hadn't ever seen. And of course, my friend introduced me and said, this is Gracie Haim. She's also a foreigner like you. So I said, oh, that's a nice way to put it, you know. But anyway, I said, hi, nice to meet you, Gracie, and shall we sit down at a table, you know. And so we sat down and talked that night, and I thought, this one I like, you know.
Where was Gracie from?
Gracie was born in Bombay, India. They left Bombay, India in 1959, I think, because they kept the British independence, you know, and went to London. And then in London, she was there to 1963 when she came to the United States to help her sister, Sophie Carver, which lived in Canoga Park also, and she wasn't too well at one point. So Gracie came to help her and stayed with her. So that's how, and she came, and they grew up in Bombay. She got an education in Bombay. She was a teacher. She had two other sisters, Sophie and Vilma, and three brothers, Benji, Abby, and Alice. And they all had gone to England, and some came to New York afterwards. But anyway, I proposed to Gracie after 3 months, and she said yes, and then her family started the So it took a little longer, but after a year, we got married on the 3rd of May, 1964. We waited a little bit to go on our honeymoon because I had worked in the Danish organizations and we had arranged a trip to Denmark. And so during the summer, we went to first to New York, and there we went to the World's Fair in 1964, saw the World's Fair. And the next day we took off for Denmark, and we went and visited my family, and afterwards we went to England and visited Gracie's family. And then afterwards we came back and we settled down in my apartment in Canoga Park. And a year later we bought a home also in Canoga Park on Woodlake Avenue, and we moved in. And shortly thereafter, and we had moved in, we fixed up the house, and it was real neat and nice. And we had our first baby in the 14th of June of 1965. And that is Birgitte. And then a year later, or 13 months later, we had our daughter. She was born also on the 14th, but of July of 1966. That's Tina. And so I worked for Litton Industry, and we had quite a happy life there and enjoyed ourselves. And later on, when we had in 77, we moved to Simi Valley because of busing problems and all. And I had gone through so many things, so I figured it was better to. And I was also in real estate business out here in Simi, so I figured that would be a nice place to move to. And this was the house that we saw, because we sit up on a hillside, and when it's not raining, then you can look over the whole valley and see all the mountains there surround us all the way around. And so we still live here. Of course, the house was kind of demolished a little bit when during the earthquake, but we are back in shape as I'm sitting here and talking to you. We have been involved in many different organizations through times, and the Danish clubs, and we have gone to Bet Kodesh. That was where Gracie and I got married, by our Rabbi Shochet. We have held contact. I became member of an organization called Friends of Scandinavia, which really came out of the big organization there's in New York with Mr. Netter and Victor Borge started a group there that's called Thanks to Scandinavia, but ours became Friends of Scandinavia. And what we do is we help young students that come over from Denmark. They study at the universities here in California. And that's one of my pet organizations. And I go and speak to groups around, to temples, schools, churches, whatever. And I relay the story about the flights and how the Danes helped the fellow man, and etc. So I also now have helped for the last 10 years, but now I'm on the board of directors of a Danish immigrant museum, which the museum is placed in Elkhorn, Iowa, because that's the center of where all Danes came from Denmark from the middle of the 1700s and up to 1800s and now even in the 1900s. It's called Across Ocean, Across Time. And that is one of the most beautiful places I ever seen outside of Denmark. And that's where they placed the museum. The two things that my mother took from Germany and brought them back to Denmark, I asked her in 1956 what she was going to do with them. She said, I don't know. She said, you want them. And I said, yes. And for 40 years, I have kept them. And here, a couple of weeks ago, we had a general board meeting in Solvang, which is the Danish capital of California. We had a board meeting where board members come from all over the United States. And I asked the president if we have a Holocaust exhibit at this Danish museum, which is very befitting because Victor Borge has been involved and many other Danish Jews also have been involved in the museum. So I thought that I would donate the book and the shawl from this preacher, and that could be hanging at the Danish Museum or be shown with the other Holocaust exhibits that they have. And so I said that I would love to give them to the museum because I thought that would be a beautiful resting place for those two items. And of course I didn't think it was such a great thing. Everybody stood up and applauded and thought it was absolutely fantastic. I will get some pictures later of it that I was taking that day. But I thought that it was such a neat idea and I knew my mother would like it. So I did it and I said to Gracie, it's so nice to know that now a lot of other people will have the time to see them. And of course, like I say, if I can say it now that I'm sitting and speak, I think that Steven Spielberg is doing such a fabulous job here. And I saw his movie, and I were not a bit, like so many, but uncomfortable because I had gone through it. So I know at what was happening there was as authentic as you can get to it. And I just hope that Mr. Spielberg will come one day to the Danish Museum, that he also know that many Danes throughout the United States have done much for the world. Like we had a Dane that fell at the Alamo, we had the Danish war minister during the Second World War was a Dane, etc., etc. So I think that is part of my story, and I hope and I say thank you for having the opportunity to speak on the tape, and I would like to say it, mange tak, for jeg har fået lov til at sidde her og tale, og det har været mig en ære. Mange tak. Thank you. Just let her do it.
I would like to introduce Bent Lerno and his wife.
I like to introduce my wife. This is Gracie Haim Lerno. We got married the 3rd of May, 1964, and we are soon coming up on our 32nd wedding anniversary. We are the one that have two children. My oldest daughter is, they say here Bridget, but it is in Danish, it's Birgitte, like beer and gitte. So it's Birgitte, and our second daughter is Tina. And Tina lives in Hollywood, and she works for a company called The Seven Level, which make CD-ROMs. She is a color coordinator when they make CDs. And my other daughter, Birgitte, lives in San Diego, is married and live in San Diego, and they have a nice condo. And she works for, I don't know what the company is called, for telling you that she just started there, but she is the inboard, it's a worldwide corporation, she is the inboard travel agent. And she is super, and she is sports like golf, tennis, swimming. She has always been, Tina hated all kinds of sports, so it's a whole different world with those two. But Gracie and I have had a nice life together, and we have, we think, a very beautiful home, especially after we rebuilt it. Whatever you see on all the walls in the house that you're here today, is everything is new because everything came down. I like, and Gracie too, we like to collect art and artwork and art pieces, and we have done very well with it. It was my brother in Denmark that got me interested in modern art. He has probably private collection in Denmark, one of the biggest modern art collections at his house. And so I took from it, and some of my sculptures here and all, we have dragged them from Denmark here, you know. And but we just enjoyed it, and have enjoyed our kids and our life. So, and Gracie, I don't want to advertise for it, but she works for a big airline and as a flight attendant now, has been for the last 20 years or right there about.
Just about. Mm-hmm.
And so I'm retired, and I do a lot of work for, like I say, for different organizations. We also have, of course, an organization which is called Rebuild Society. That's an organization with that celebrates the 4th of July with United States. And every year in Denmark, in the city of Rebild, we celebrate 4th of July, and about 10 to 20,000 people come say every year.
Would you like to say something, Gracie?
I'd love to. I just want to say it's been very exciting being married to Bent.
Tell us a little bit about your mom and dad and where they came from.
Okay, I met Bent some 33 years ago in a Hebrew at the synagogue.
I already told that.
Okay, and I'm originally from Bombay, India, and my mother came from Baghdad and met my father. It was a match arranged marriage, like they used to do in those days. In India, we have about 1 million Indian Jews living there, and so I'm very proud to be part of that community. My grandmother and grandfather had to escape Iraq and flee to Israel over land and water to get there. So that's another story that they had to go through. And it was very exciting to meet my grandmother for just once in my lifetime.
Your father worked?
My father was the first Jewish lawyer in India, and his family was very well known, the Haim family. His sister was the first Jewish nurse. And
of course, what is your mother's background? What was her name?
My mother's name was Emma Eliyahu Sassoon.
Thank you very much, both of you. And now we'll continue with the pictures.
Thank you. The picture you see right now is my grandmother on my mother's side. Her name is Johanna Löwenberg Salomon. She was born in 1854, and she lived till 1904. So I have never seen her.
Where was this taken?
That was taken in Copenhagen. This is my grandfather on my mother's side. His name is Jakob Hartvig Salomon. And the picture was taken in Copenhagen in the beginning of the 1900s. This appeared in a local newspaper, Simi Valley, The Enterprise. It was my story about immigrant fleeing the Nazi. In the background, you see my mom and my dad. It is Martha Lerno and Herman Lerno. And the front is myself, Bent Lerno. This picture was taken in 1928 in Charlottenlund, Denmark. The two that are standing in the background, on the left is my father, Herman Lerno. On the right is my brother, Harry Lerno. Seated, starting from the left, is my brother, Richard, the oldest. Then the next one on his lap is myself, Bent Lerno. The third one from the left is my brother, Paul Lerno. And seated next to Paul is my sister, Ida. And the last one is my mother, Martha Lerno. This was taken in Charlottenlund, Denmark. This picture was taken in 1945 in July. That was the Danish Brigade, or Danfoss. We were lying down in the southern part of Denmark, between the border between Denmark and Germany. And that picture was taken when I was on guard duty. This is Bent Lerno. This is also myself, Bent Lerno. This is taken in 1946 in Copenhagen. Thank you. This picture was taken of Gracie Lerno and myself in 1964, the 3rd of May, when we got married in Temple Bet Kodesh in Canoga Park in California. Simi Valley, no, I should say Canoga Park, California. This is my two daughters I have with Gracie, which you just saw the wedding picture. On the left is Tina, and on the right is Birgitte. That was on her wedding day in 1991. This is my oldest grandson, Simon Miera. He is my daughter in Denmark, Debbie Miera, and he will be this year 15 years old. And this picture is of my granddaughter, Natalie, also daughter of Debbie Miera in Copenhagen, Denmark.
How old is she?
She is 13 years old. This is my twin grandchildren, also children of Debbie Miera in Copenhagen, Denmark. From the left, you see Denise, and on the right is David. They are 8 years of age today. This picture you see now was taken on the 5th of May, 1995. It is the 50th anniversary of the Danish military group that both my brother Paul and I belong to, the Danfoss. And we were home celebrating the liberation 50 years later. The background is the Danish palace that's under repair, but you see the split Danish flag. So, 5th of May, 1995, Copenhagen, Denmark. Thank you.